the 130 millimeter cooler clearance in the Ncase M1 is the limiting factor for your cooler selection. That means typically a 92 millimeter tower cooler is the best you can do. But there's an exception. Today, let's take a look at a few different tower coolers for this little case. Welcome to Machines & More. I haven't done too much content on the M1, but as many of you know, this is my personal video editing machine, and I hope to do some more content on this guy going forward. And it's just hard to play around with it and also need to use it at the same time. It's a good time to take a look at some coolers since I came across a duo of interesting coolers to show you guys. Now the installation with these is generally uneventful and pretty similar, so I won't spend too much time commenting on that. So let's just jump right into the lineup here. This one for me is the most interesting one today, and this is the new Thermalright Silver Soul 135. This one was actually sent to us by a friend of the channel in China. So big thanks to you, Dan, for making this review possible. Another one is the ID Cooling SE-904-XT, and this one was sent to us by ID Cooling, so big thanks to them as well. And our baseline comparison today will be against a cooler I love and know very well, because I've been using this one in my personal machine. This is the Noctua U9S. So real quick overview on these coolers. The new Silver Soul 135 is special because it uses this 120 millimeter sort of fan with the corners paired off. And this fan slots right in the middle of the dual towers, just like that. And it sits just over those heatsink screws into the recesses on the fans. And that allows it to do what very few other tower coolers allow us to do in the Ncase M1. That's fit this 120 millimeter fan. Now a good portion of the fan does overhang the heatsink, but we'll check in on the thermal performance shortly and see if that even matters. This one is the evolution of the Silver Arrow 130, minus the bloody installation process that has now been etched into folklore. And I think a lot more of you will be interested in this one because it's a bit more conventional in its heatsink design, and it's less dangerous to mount. Now the M1 technically has a height restriction of 130 millimeters, but I had absolutely zero problems getting this 135 millimeter cooler to fit and for that panel to close. No problem at all. It's a dual tower design, and one of the things that is most promising about this is that it manages to fit six heat pipes into what is a fairly compact design, and it is a very hefty heatsink at about 615 grams. The base plate is polished nickel-plated copper, and the overall build quality is average. The cover plates, they came a little bit crooked, the paint on it, it's a little inconsistent, but at the end of the day, it's not terrible. In the M1, a 92 millimeter fan can fit on the back still with this cooler, so I did test it out with the Noctua A9x25 in rear intake with this cooler. The ID Cooling SE-904-XT is a similar design, but on a much smaller scale. Split dual towers, just like the Thermalright cooler, but it only has four heat pipes and a direct contact base plate with those heat pipes. And it is a rather lightweight heatsink at only 430 grams. Comes with just one ID fan, but ID Cooling also supplied two extra fans for the testing, so I did test it with a rear-mounted intake, that stock middle fan, and also a fan over the RAM, although that one did stick out proud from the heatsink quite a bit just because of the RAM height. So three 92 millimeter fans on this ensemble, and we'll see if that or the big fan and big heatsink from the Thermalright is more useful. For the U9S, it's a pretty commonly recommended cooler for the M1. It's a great cooler, nearly perfect build quality, and a real premium feel about this one. Heatsink mass slots right in between those two at 530 grams, as does the heat pipe count at 5. This one comes with the Noctua A9x25 fan, and I usually run this one with that extra intake fan at the rear, so that's how this one was tested. And it does have a nickel-plated copper base plate as well. So let's just jump right into the test results. For the testing, I use a 10700K with a very, very slight overclock at 4.8 GHz on all cores, locked to 1.2 volts with the MSI Z490 Unify board. I ran two sets of tests. The first one is a noise optimized and noise normalized test. For this test, the fans on all the different coolers are set to a level that yields plus 7 decibels over the noise floor. There are also two NFA12x15s at the bottom, locked to 1100 RPM, contributing to this total system noise level as well. For the U9S, that's 1700 RPM on the cooler fans. For the Thermalright, that's 1675 RPM on the cooler fan. And for the ID904XT, that's 1750 RPM. Now, I was a bit surprised initially that the three fans could run that fast compared to just two Noctua A9s, but that's just how it measured out on the decibel meter. It does have a buzz that could not be measured out necessarily, but it sounds a little bit off in terms of the noise quality, if you know what I mean. Getting into the results for this one, the standout here is the Thermalright. That's a huge, enormous gap, and I was pretty shocked how well this thing works here. The U9S is no slouch and more than capable to handle a stock 10700K, typically speaking, but locked at this voltage, this chip is pushing 160 watts or so, and that is absolutely an impressive performance from the Thermalright. The SE-904-XT wasn't up to the task here, and while it teetered at 99 degrees for a good portion of the test, it did eventually hit thermal throttle, and it teetered between 99 and 100 degrees. So that's a scratch for this test. And the U9S is somewhere between the two, not a terrible level of performance. For the next test, I wanted to see the maximum level of cooling that these coolers could deliver in the M1, regardless of noise. And there are some of you that don't really care too much about noise, or you just want to know if the cooler can handle your system in an extreme scenario, right? Again, the Silver Soul 135 impressed me here. It's not exactly quiet here at plus 10.5 decibels, but yeah, that's an absolutely fantastic temp for this chip at this power level. U9S does trail at about 8 degrees behind, albeit at a much lower noise level, and the SE-904-XT does manage to avoid thermal throttle now. But at 2300 RPM on these three fans, it is massively loud at 12.5 decibels over the noise floor, and I can absolutely hear this thing from a long way off. Just for fun, I managed to squeeze a Fantex T30 into the Silver Soul 135. Just to be clear, I don't recommend this. The panel won't close all the way and the clips don't work with the extra height of the fan, so it kind of just gets stuck in the middle there and it's not tight against the heat fins. While I don't recommend putting a different fan in this cooler necessarily for the noise optimized test, it did manage to shave off another degree and a half over the original fan, although the 92mm intake at the back does limit its efficacy somewhat. But just a little fun data point here, I think set up with this stock fan, it's already really, really impressive. As for the acoustic qualities, let's take a listen to the fans real quick at those two test levels. The SE-904-XT did have a strange buzzy quality from its fans, and I really didn't like that too much, but the Thermalright fan isn't bad at all, and this one definitely surprised me. So there are a few impressive coolers from ID Cooling, such as the SE-224-XT, and that one absolutely punches above its weight, but I think this one performs exactly as it's priced, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, it's only 30 bucks, right? And while I wouldn't recommend this one to use with even a lightly OC'd 10700K at this price bracket, I don't think this is designed to do that at all. And it's really more for the Ryzen 5 and Intel i5 level of power draw. And if you're running that level of CPU in the Ncase M1, I really don't see a big need to spend too much more unless the quality of the stock fan bothers you. The U9S has been and is still a great choice. For 92mm coolers, this is my go-to. This is a solid chunk of metal. It does limit you to two cooler fans for your cooling configuration, but it's awesome. It's just perfect, almost perfect build quality. But it is not cheap at $60 for the regular version and $70 for the Chromax Black now. But pair it with another A9 fan and you've got a very dependable and it's a great premium option for your Ncase M1. As for the Thermalright, this thing is downright ridiculous. I haven't been this impressed with a cooler for a while in terms of the design and the raw performance, and holy cow, this thing rocks the socks off even the U9S. And if you're willing to mod a regular 120mm fan to fit this thing, I think it can be done. But from what I've seen so far, there's not necessarily a huge incentive to do that because the stock fan actually works quite well. Now, getting this one can be a little bit of a tricky affair depending on where in the world you are, but for most of you, if you're comfortable using a site like AliExpress, you should be able to get this cooler, and from what I've seen just now, it's about $70 delivered to the US. Now, if Thermalright could distribute their coolers in a more mainstream fashion, that would be awesome, because this thing is super, super impressive, and I think it would be very popular, and I highly recommend it. At some point, I hope to do some M1 airflow configuration testing with both this cooler and the Noctua C14S. So hey, if you're interested in that, be sure to be subscribed and hit that bell for notifications. I will have a few product links that I'll put down below in the description, so please check those out as well. Give a like. Thanks for watching today.